what to do with somebody like you who plays so well. You know, it's really, in some cases, just a question of a couple of details, but a few things that I think we looked at a little bit earlier this week, some of the things that I've mentioned to you. And it's interesting to hear you in this context because I get a little bit different picture of you and your playing. And also about some of the things that we were discussing and their possible importance, just in terms of your playing and your ability to continue to progress, you know, and keep reaching farther and farther. And I do notice in your playing that there are times some of these things are purely technical, but of course they'll have musical implications. That sometimes you're very free with your left hand, and there are other times, as we discussed, you're just holding on with all fingers, vibrating one of them, and collapsing the other ones, you know, and even collapsing the one that you're vibrating, for no apparent reason to me, you know, whereas you don't always do this. And I notice that every time you actually allow each finger to be free, each playing finger, and to do whatever it needs to do. Right now we're speaking about vibrato, but you know, it relates to any aspect of any left-hand action, but you seem to be playing at a higher level. And the moment when you start depressing the other fingers and breaking them at the last joint, it sounds very good. It doesn't quite sound as free as when you really are allowing each finger to find its maximum expression. Maximum expression, but why? Because each finger is more centered. Each finger is really operating to maximum efficiency. You know, this all sounds very scientific, but let's face it, with somebody who plays on your level, you know, we're not talking about, you know, the differences that will be made at this point are not, you know, 180 degrees apart. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We're talking about details that for you become extremely important. It's the question of just continuing, striving for more and more, hearing more and more, demanding more, but also making sure that you're not creating blockages for yourself and hindrances. Obstacles. Problems?
Oh.
You know, like as if you close a door, mm-hmm. you decide you're not going to go through that door. Mm-hmm. There's no reason for you to close these doors now. Close them. When you get to my age, you'll have a bunch of closed doors, but you know, you're not there yet. No, but you know what I mean. There's no reason, since much of the time you don't do this kind of thing. That's what's curious. It's not like you always do it. And when you're not doing this, really, you just do such beautiful things. And I just wish that you would be more conscious about it more often. Mm-hmm. So it's not a haphazard thing, okay? Another thing, and this is a very personal thing, and I know we're on the air and everything, but I feel the need to say it because, as I say, now I hear you more in a performance context. And I'm sitting a little bit farther away. Mm-hmm. You know, you're playing through the piece and you're very involved and so forth. So, you know, it's interesting for me to hear certain things. And as I say, this is a personal thing, but I think I would be remiss if I didn't at least mention it. Extra musical sounds. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
What am I talking about?
It's like, or something.
That's one of them. It comes in different guises. Now, I think I understand that it's basically coming from an emotional response. The trouble is, when it's actually audible, a few rows away.
You can hear it right here.
Sometimes. Okay? Now, I think you probably yourself could detect moments when these kinds of things happen. You know? Because you're feeling some extra special emotion. It might be a shift that you're a little bit concerned about. You know? Things like that. Try to be aware of this in your practicing. I don't believe that this is completely absent in your practicing and that it only happens when you perform. Maybe I'm wrong. But this is for you to verify, okay? And in those moments, try to open your air passages and breathe, you know?
It's so hard to breathe.
Oh, I know. But you're still doing it because if you didn't breathe at all in the Schumann Concerto, right now you'd be dead. You know. So you are breathing. But it's a question in those moments, whether it's because of a special emotional response or a response to an upcoming difficulty or something like that. We understand these things. They happen. Those are the moments in your practicing where I think you have to be especially concerned about your breathing. This is not something to be thinking about while you're performing. You know, you don't want to be preoccupied with that. Mm-hmm. Other than, perhaps, before you go on and perform, just do a couple of, you know, breathing exercises. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if we discussed any of that back in the studio. Exercises, there are various exercises. I don't think we'll go into that now. But there are various exercises whereby you exhale and you raise your arms up to this level or this level, you know, with four equal breaths and back down again, exhaling, things like that. It's a way of just trying to time your breathing with physical motions. You can do it with the bow. You know, those of us that worked with Mr. Sharker know these exercises, of course. You see the point.
Yeah, but when you do you feel you lift your shoulder or somewhere?
Absolutely not. You do not lift your shoulders. You feel your lungs and you keep this whole mechanism free. The point of stopping the breath is just to time it with equal lengths of bow. Eventually, of course, you do that with a smooth bow and time your breath so that it extends the length of the bow outwards and inwards. Exhaling, inhaling, etc. Things like that. Now, it's difficult to apply that precisely to what you play, well, how you practice, but you can actually. You take a phrase and see how your breathing relates to that. And I think you'll find yourself. You know, it's not really a question of calculating all of this stuff. It's keeping it free. And especially not holding your breath. Because that, I think, is what's happening. You start to hold your breath, and then other sounds come out, okay? I don't want to belabor that. I've said it. So now, do think about it, please, you know, when you're practicing. In your practicing, how to actually somehow reproduce the kind of stress or tension that exists when we are performing. But you know, you can do certain things. For example, you put the cello down, you leave the room, you imagine that it's 5 minutes to concert time. Get yourself in that frame of mind. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah, imagine that there are 2,000 people out there, you're going to finish your mountain. Mm-hmm. You walk out, you pick up the cello, and you start to play. Mm-hmm. You know, that helps. What we will never truly be able to reproduce everything about concert playing unless we're playing in concerts, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the values, of course, besides just the enjoyment of playing, but playing concerts and having the stress is to understand what it is, in fact, we need to practice, not just in learning the piece or learning a passage, but what happens to us under stress so that when we practice, we can be more aware of what to do to counteract problems that come up. You know, that's another aspect. You know, we always say you can practice 100 hours and then in 30 minutes you learn more on stage than you did in those 100 hours. And that's true. You know, the learning curve is much quicker when, because all the senses are heightened and things happen in a magnified way. You know, so this is all good. That teaches you what you really need to practice, okay? Now, just a couple of things about the Schumann Concerto. It's true one could interpret that accent many different ways. And you interpret it as a kind of shock. I was shocked, okay? So that's fine. However, what happens when it comes in the F sharp minor? Is it the same shock? You did it the same way.
Mm-hmm.
You did your shocking accent. It could be, but it strikes me that after hearing all this music up to that point, and now we're in F sharp minor, that the same accent, the same kind of character of the accent that you played wouldn't apply here. There's an accent, but it's not the same kind of accent. I don't know how it's different, but the context is different. So therefore, the character of the sound is different, the atmosphere of that phrase is different in that key, at that point, before we have the transition back to the return. So the accent would be different as well, okay? That's, in other words, an accent can be many different things in a different context, okay? That's all I'm asking, is just to consider what the accent may be at this moment, okay? Now, what I'd like to do is, the whole first page was, I honestly have nothing to say, so let's leave the first page. Well, I don't know your edition.
I have a question.
Okay, I don't know if I have an answer, but I'll listen to it.
Just for this accent, at the beginning, I won't make it like moon, but it's like moon, like this. But now it sounds like sharp.
It is rather sharp.
Sharp.
You want it to be warmer.
Yeah.
Think about the timing of the shift as it relates to the bow.
Mm-hmm.
And then what you do with the vibrato when you arrive on that note. The actual arrival of it. Do you want to play it again? Let's just play the A. How do you hear the A? Now you have it. Now you just have to. In whose book? What would you call that then? Nothing? You're doing something. What would you call it? Would you call it a forte piano?
No.
Sforzando?
Yeah.
You would call it a sforzando?
Yeah.
This?
No, it's not. This.
You would call that a sforzando?
Yeah.
That I would call it sforzando.
It's
not. Yeah, but you didn't want to play it that way. You wanted something like... So what do you call that? The point is, notation is very insufficient to describe all the characters that music can have.
Mm-hmm.
It's true. What do we have? A few indications. Accent, line, dot, sforzando. This is rather poor. When you consider that there are millions and millions and millions ad infinitum expressions possible.
Mm-hmm.
And we have four or five markings for that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So therefore, an accent itself is a marking that indicates some type of expression or stress.
Mm-hmm.
Within the context, each different context, it can mean an entirely different thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's true. Okay, let's try. What about that accent? There's an accent on the D sharp, right?
Yeah.
Is that the same accent as the one in the A? Okay, so tell me, describe to me what kinds of differences that one has from the one on the A.
More deeper.
Yeah, but there's something else that's really important there. The D sharp comes on what beat?
Seven.
Yeah. So. It's a rhythmic accent as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just a gestural accent. It's a rhythmic accent. Why? Because without that accent, we would want to accentuate the E.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, it creates more drama on that D sharp.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it has a rhythmic element to it as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The first one isn't essentially a rhythmic accent. It's an expressive accent.
Yeah.
It gives expression to that rising figure.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we can discuss that, just my feeling about it. It's not the truth. Just my truth. Okay. Let's go now. Okay. Yeah, you can just go. Okay. So, Schumann writes what here? D, but he puts an indication there. What indication? Do you remember?
Subsonal and then, no, it's 40 piano.
forte piano mean? You've got a lot of notes in that figure. So is it just forte? Now piano.
It should be sustained.
So there's an example. We're told when we're little, forte piano means play very loud and then immediately soft. And now you have a phrase where if you do that, you'll have one note that's expressive and the rest of them are completely dead. Nothing's happening. So forte piano does not mean that here, does it?
No.
It's actually a forte piano that goes over a large group of notes.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
Okay, he could have written diminuendo, but then you might have played it. Didn't want that either.
No.
Okay. So you see, these markings are insufficient. They mean something different in each case. Okay, let's try. So I would leave something to continue on. That's a beautiful point in the phrase where it turns around. You don't want to rush through that. You're always sort of pushing through that. That's an important turn in the phrase. Larger interval and a closer one. This is important. The A to the F. Yes, and then the C sharp. Because the normal note is B. In this case, yes. But the B is still important, so don't drop it.
Okay.
It's, in a sense, a decoration of the B. And it has more character because it, in a way, acts as a dissonance against the B, right? But in order to feel that, we have to hear the B as well. Don't drop the B just because we stress the C. Okay? And in one groove. No, not separated. Here you're stuck. You get whatever vibrato you get. That's it. Okay? And it sounded pretty good. And when you do this, you're controlling it. Your ear is telling your body what to do. You're not creating a blockage. Okay? To do that where you keep the fingers always in this their natural curve and not to break the last joints. First when you have the second down. You don't need the second when you have the third down. Okay? Unless you specifically want to restrict the motion of your vibrato. I don't know why you'd want to do that. Because you can create a smaller or larger vibrato with your arm. You know? Thank you. do that. Keep the fingers free. What to do with them, okay?
Okay.
Do you see what I mean?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go to tom tom da 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 da. Just want to make sure it was in your edition. There's something that we call a carat, right?
Yeah.
Bom bom. Could it be possible that if you play down down, bom, you can give a sense of that articulation. Mm-hmm. Om, om, down, down. Use a lot of bow. It still, it functions like an upbeat.
You mean it's more bow, not?
No, all I'm saying is, I'm just suggesting a bowing
mm-hmm.
to help the character, but not to change the character, so. Tom, bom,
oh,
no,
okay.
Just bom, bee.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
And I think ultimately the gesture is freer
mm-hmm.
than playing it up bow.
Uh-huh.
Yeah? Let's try that. Joe?
Yeah?
Could I ask you to try that figure, those triplet figures, without breaking the last
mm-hmm.
joints of your fingers? Is that possible?
Yeah, I try.
Just try one slowly. Let's see. Even the form. Yes. Even the first finger. Yes. Can't do it.
Mm.
You're not happy about it.
I'm not comfortable.
Huh?
I'm not used to it. But yeah.
Actually, that's not true. You do it sometimes.
Oh.
That's the thing. It's a bit haphazard with you. You don't always do this.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't always do this. But I think actually you're always playing at your best this way.
Mm. Okay.
That's what I noticed when you played the movie through. Okay.
Mm.
So I think it is of value. Okay.
Mm.
Let's skip now to you know that next section.
Mm.
Yeah, she knows. Well, you know after the 2B. Yeah.
Oh, here. Sorry.
This is a new chapter in the story. This is something new.
Mm.
I mean, it relates obviously to this, because he keeps using these kinds of figures, these transitional figures in the cello. This is a different one.
Mm.
This is a totally new character.
Mm.
You know, like a breath of fresh air came into the room, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's you. You're the breath of fresh air. And free, he writes nothing. You're totally alone. So you're free to do what you want.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important. In this piece, you'll notice, he gives you rhythmic figures, and then sometimes he leaves you alone.
Mm-hmm.
He just gives you bum, bum, bum.
Mm-hmm.
You can be free with that. You can stay strictly in time if you want.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's Schumann's way of saying, these bars are not strict. Harmony change, harmony change. Quasi recitativo. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not really a recitativo in the strict sense, but it functions like that.
Mm.
You know? Okay?
Mm.
This is a bar. He gives you a chord, and you're all alone into the next measure.
Mm-hmm.
So if you play, feel strict, unnecessarily strict.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
shouldn't be obvious. But if you accent the middle of the bar, it sounds square. That's why I made a point of a phrasing, you know, after the third beat, just to give some a nicer curve to the line, okay? That will help, I think. You're going vertically with your left arm, okay? Does the music just go that way? No. So what we want to do is get away from this vertical feeling in the cello, huh? Right? So don't orient yourself vertically. It's fine, but the music doesn't have space, right? Is that a surprise note?
Yes.
You should.
I think
so. I would say no.
You mean, I didn't play like surprise player?
What would be the surprise? Is the surprise. It could, probably the normal note would be E natural. But I think it's the register change is that makes it surprising. So maybe that's what we should be listening for. Maybe in this case, what is it, sforzando? Yeah, the sforzando perhaps is not a forte sforzando, but just a little sudden jolt. And then, there. Joe, we are unfortunately quickly running out of time. But I wanted to ask you if you had any questions or anything that we didn't touch on that's of
of importance to you. When I play here.
That was the place. Could I make a suggestion? Think of it like Bach. What's important? between sort of fill the space, you know, with beauty. But those are the primary notes. Those are the ones that create the overall shape of the line. Mm. In that respect, think of it like Bach, like we do when we play the suites. Mm. We're thinking of an ascending or descending bass line. Mm. We keep track of that in our mind. And whatever we do in between doesn't disturb that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
No? That's, I think, what's important. Mm. Probably elongated notes, a little bit, but not all the same, because they're in a sequence, right? So they're not all of equal importance. They go down, come back up, you know. Mm-hmm. In that respect, like Bach, you know, bring out the sort of that extra line that's there, which we don't hear all the time.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
It's very lovely.